Flashing across California desert skies, the airplanes you see here are writing new chapters in the story of man-made flight. They are the unique scientific tools of a cooperative program of high-speed flight research, conducted jointly by the Navy, the Air Force, the nation's aircraft manufacturers, and the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics. A program which is daily pushing farther beyond the aviation frontier marked by the speed of sound. Conceived in 1944, this program consists of obtaining in actual flight much of the detailed information necessary for designing new types of aircraft which can operate safely and efficiently at transonic and supersonic speeds. When the high-speed flight research program was initiated during the closing days of World War II, aerodynamic theory had been able to predict, and wind tunnel experiments had been able to visualize some of the problems associated with compressibility. This sequence, taken in a wind tunnel by means of a special optical device, shows a shockwave formation, that jamming together of the air at the speed of sound, which causes drastic increases in drag, severe buffeting, and dangerous control changes. In addition, wartime airplanes forced into high-velocity dives had graphically demonstrated the accompanying hazards. But wind tunnels of the period could not completely bridge the gap between the subsonic and supersonic zones. And the diving of subsonic airplanes at speeds for which they were never designed could be a hazardous business. It remained for the high-speed flight program, an undertaking in which private industry, the armed forces, and the government's aeronautical research agency are participating as partners, to attack these problems with scientific facilities of a new kind, the research airplanes. Powerful enough to explore the transonic zone in level or even climbing flight, rather than in dangerous dives. Sufficiently rugged to withstand very high structural stresses, and so completely instrumented that they have been called flying laboratories. Nerve center of the program is this field station, which the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, popularly known as NACA, operates at Edwards Air Force Base in California. The station is staffed by the engineers, pilots, technicians, and other experts necessary to fly and maintain the airplanes and process and interpret the data obtained from research flights. Located in the Mojave Desert on a dry lake near what was once known as Muroc, the base is ideally suited for this type of program. As these scenes indicate, the dry lake offers an immense natural landing field, a vital factor in the operation of new and unconventional airplanes with very high landing speeds. Here the camera presents an aerial view of one of the landing strips, nearly 10 miles long, which has been marked off on the hard, smooth surface of the lake bed. Now let us inspect the airplanes themselves, lined up in front of the NACA hangar. That is the consolidated Vultee XF-92 in the background. Next, the Douglas D-558-2 and the D-558-1. Then the Bell X-5, the Bell X-1, and finally, the Northrop X-4. We're at the loading pit where one of the airplanes you just saw is being prepared for flight. This is Bell Aircraft Corporation's X-1, first of the NACA high-speed research airplanes and trailblazer in supersonic flight. Built under Air Force contract, it has a reaction motors rocket engine. The X-1 is carried aloft by this Boeing B-50 bomber and released. The bomber has been positioned over the pit. The hoisting slings raise the X-1 into the bomb bay. Next, the landing gear is checked. The research ship is now ready for loading of rocket propellants. Alcohol and liquid oxygen are the main fuels. Nitrogen is used to force these fuels into the engine. This yellow trailer contains the alcohol, which will be pumped into the X-1's tanks. With fueling completed, the two airplanes are moved to the starting ramp. The pilots hold a short briefing. The crew climbs aboard the B-50. The engines of the bomber are warmed up, and it taxis out toward the end of the runway. Clearance under the X-1 is only about 9 inches, but that is sufficient for takeoff or even an emergency landing. The mothership takes off with its load. The X-1 pilot is riding in the bomber. Later, he will enter the research airplane and prepare for the drop. The bomber has climbed to a point 5 miles above the desert, and preparations are being made to release the X-1. That puff of vapor cleared the fuel lines. And there she goes. In a matter of seconds, the X-1 has left the camera plane far behind. At the NACA field station, radar crews track the research flight. Out on the lake bed, the operations jeep maintains radio communications with the X-1. Its fuel exhausted, the X-1 glides down to the lake bed. The landing is quite fast, about 135 miles per hour. And the airplane rolls more than a mile before being braked to a stop. The pilot climbs out of his cramped quarters. The research plane is towed back to the station where results of the flight will be analyzed. A second product of Bell Air Force NACA cooperative effort is the X-5, one of the newest and most remarkable airplanes to join the research program. In this airplane, the pilot can slowly but surely vary the angle at which the wings are swept back, as demonstrated here. This makes it possible to study in actual flight the aerodynamic effects of wing sweep. Ranging from an acute angle while flying in the transonic speed range to a nearly straight wing at takeoff and landing. These low speeds are the most critical for the ultra-fast airplanes of the future, which must employ swept-back wings to soften the adverse effects near sonic speed. After ground tests at the Bell factory, the X-5 was packed into a Fairchild C-119 flying boxcar and flown across country from Buffalo, New York to California. Unlike its predecessor, the X-1, the X-5 is propelled by an Allison jet engine and takes off under its own power rather than being dropped from a mother ship. The X-5 is the result of 3 years of painstaking research and development by the Air Force, the NACA, and Bell Aircraft Engineers. The Northrop X-4 is another research airplane of unusual design. It was built by Northrop Aircraft Incorporated for the Air Force to study stability and control problems associated with the tailless flying wing type of aircraft. Power is supplied by 2 Westinghouse jet engines. Here a technician is checking the airplane's dive brakes. Before the flight begins, the research pilot and the Air Force pilot, who will escort him, talk things over. This chase pilot provides a vital safety factor. Throughout the research flight, he will ride herd on the X-4, ready to warn the NACA pilot if anything goes wrong. The X-4 taxis out for takeoff. Behind it is the chase airplane, a North American F-86 fighter. The two airplanes have climbed to the proper altitude. At this point, the X-4 begins a series of maneuvers while its instruments automatically keep a record of what is happening. Now the pilot is going to open the X-4 dive brakes. Watch how the speed drops and the F-86 shoots ahead. The flight is over. The X-4, still paced by the F-86, lands on the paved runway. The camera turns now to the Convair XF-92A, one of the world's first airplanes to have a triangular or delta wing. This airplane was created by the Consolidated Vultee Aircraft Corporation for the Air Force. Like the X-4, the 92 lacks elevators on the tail structure. The functions of both elevators and ailerons are combined in elevons, located on the trailing edge of the wing. The XF-92 has an Allison jet engine with an afterburner to give additional thrust. In addition to certain aerodynamic advantages, the triangular design provides adequate structural strength for the highly swept-back type of wing by filling in the V-shaped area between the trailing edges. An early arrival at the Edwards base was the Douglas Aircraft Company's D-558 Phase 1, the Skystreak, which was built for the Navy for research at high subsonic speeds. It is powered by a General Electric Allison jet engine. At one time, the research airplanes were painted orange or red. More recently, this was changed to white to facilitate visual tracking against the dark blue sky. Coming in for a landing is the Navy's Douglas D-558 Phase 2, called the Skyrocket. It has gone faster and higher than man has ever before flown. Now, thanks to careful planning and scientific instrumentation, it is bringing back records of great value in designing tomorrow's military and civil airplanes. The Skyrocket in 1951 flew 1,238 miles per hour and climbed to more than 79,000 feet. It is the first of the research airplanes to have swept back wings. It carries some 500 pounds of data recording instruments of the type shown here, which have been removed for inspection. Because of the many and complex variables of high-speed flight, these devices play a vital role in the research program, providing scientists with accurate information on altitude, speed, pressures, control responses, stresses, and so forth. For example, the nose boom is equipped to transmit airspeed, angle of attack, and angle of yaw. Here we see at close range an oscillograph, which keeps a record of stresses transmitted from strain gauges located throughout the airplane. Literally hundreds of pressure measurements on wing and tail surfaces are relayed to this 60-cell manometer. Forces required to move controls are registered on this galvanometer. This is an inverter, which supplies electric power to the instrument. Continuous records of speed and altitude are fed into this little black box called an airspeed altimeter. The function of this instrument is to keep an account of the various accelerations experienced by the airplane in flight. Finally, we see a newer, more compact 24-cell manometer for recording pressure distributions. A number of flight instruments have been developed by the NACA. Many operate on the principle of colored light beams registered on photographic film, as shown here. Before a flight, the instrument hatch, located behind the cockpit, is removed. technicians load photographic film into the various instruments. On this moving film will be recorded a mass of data needed to assist airplane designers. Some of the instruments are located in the belly of the airplane. Meanwhile, NACA engineers meet with the pilots to discuss the day's flight plan. Another pre-flight procedure is the engine checkout. The skyrocket is being towed from the NACA hangar. It rides on a special trailer designed by the Douglas Company. The trailer contains all the facilities needed for checking the power plants. One of the first steps is an igniter check. You are looking into the four rocket tubes in the tail of the airplane. The dots of light in the center of each tube show the spark plugs are functioning. Propellants for the rocket engine are alcohol and liquid oxygen, forced into the motor by hydrogen peroxide of 90% strength. In such concentrated form, it must be handled very carefully. The peroxide in your medicine cabinet runs about 3%. The loading crews wear protective clothing and take other precautions, such as flooding the concrete with water. If exposed to the hydrogen peroxide, they step under a shower in the trailer. Fueling completed, the rocket engine is given a ground check run. The four tubes are fired in succession. The roar is deafening. Shock waves can be seen forming in the rocket blast. The skyrocket is now towed to its mothership, a Boeing B-29 bomber. The B-29, which will drop the research ship at high altitude, has been elevated on jacks. It is lowered after the smaller airplane is positioned under the bomb bay. This version of the skyrocket has both a Westinghouse jet engine and reaction motors rockets. On this flight, only the rockets will be used. The mothership taxis out to the runway and takes off. Long vapor trails stream from the bomber as it climbs higher and higher. Finally, the drop altitude is reached. Inside the B-29, a crewman lifts the canopy of the skyrocket. The NACA pilot lowers himself into the cockpit. He tightens and checks his safety harness and makes final preparations for the drop. A quick signal, and the canopy is closed. Everything is ready for the release. The pilot of the mothership counts the final seconds before releasing the research plane. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, drop. The skyrocket and its pilot are cut loose for another assault on the frontiers of flight. As in all research flights, the skyrocket is being tracked by radar crews. This is the interior of the radar trailer with an engineer busy at the scopes. In addition, research data recorded on the airplane's instruments are automatically telemetered to this station at the NACA's research center. Another precautionary measure is the recording, both stenographically and on tape, of the test pilot's remarks throughout the flight. The skyrocket is ready to land. Colored smoke flares are lighted on the lake bed to show wind direction. Another successful research flight is over. Instrument film drums removed from the research ship are unloaded in the station darkroom. There they are developed and dried. The records are turned over to a staff of trained computers. Working with the engineers in charge of each project, these computers convert the raw data into usable form and plot it on graphs.